This is a production of Cornell University.
Please welcome Dr. Larry Chase. Thank you, Larry.
Thank you. Good morning to everybody. And it's good to have a chance to visit with you a little bit to lay the groundwork for how methane is produced and some things we can do about it. Next slide. Next. I'm going to give the summary first. The summary is optimal rumen function is the key to environmentally sustainable cows. And so really the rest of the talk, we're going to back up and verify why that is true. Next slide. So what are the objectives when we put together a ration for dairy cows? Well, we obviously want to maximize intake, milk production, keep the cows healthy, have the cows breed back, have the dairyman make a profit, enough nutrients for growth of either the cow or heifers. And we always also want to put in here, we want to minimize the excretion of nutrients back into the environment. Next slide. Let's think what a cow has to do every day to make 100 pounds of milk. And that's about 12 gallons, basically. She has to drink 35 to 45 gallons of water. And she's going to consume 125, 145 pounds of wet feed. That's the input to the factory. The output is that 100 pounds of milk plus about 160, 190 pounds of manure. Next slide. What does a cow have to do within the body to make these 12 gallons of milk? She has to find 7 to 8 pounds of glucose, which is sugar. She has to make 3 to 4 pounds of microbial protein, needs to make 2 to 2.5 pounds of amino acids. These are the precursors that she needs to make milk, milk protein, and milk fat. All of these are produced by the cow from the nutrients contained in the feed. So you can see that this cow is really working very hard to provide these nutrients to support milk production. Next slide. Next, there we go. So let's think now, how do we convert these various feeds into milk? Because these are feeds like cottonseed and hay and the corn silage. How does a cow take these and make them into milk? Next slide. Well, if we look at the slide from Greg Penner at the University of Saskatchewan, at the top, the cow consumes the feed, then as it moves to the right, the microbes digest it, the microbes grow, the microbes produce energy and protein. The cow regulates the environment for the microbes to grow. So that's sort of the basic scheme for how the rumen functions. Next slide. If we then take a look at what's different about the digestive system of the cow versus humans and monogastrics, it's the rumen, the number one and number two, the reticulum. Those two sections of the cow are not present in monogastrics and humans. And the rumen is really that big fermentation vat, which could end up in a large cow to be 40 to 50 gallons of liquid. Next slide. So what's the environment like within the rumen that these microorganisms live? Well, first it's anaerobic, no oxygen, a constant temperature, about 39 degrees. You can see pH is sort of 6.66. Saliva buffers. It's fairly wet, only 10-15% dry matter, and it's continually mixing and turning around with chewing, rumination, regurgitation of that system. Next slide. Dr. Paul Weimer at the U.S. Dairy Forage Center put this little chart together to show what types of microorganisms are in the rumen. And the first group is bacteria. They make up almost 98% of the total numbers, about 60% of the weight. And what do? They take fiber, starch, sugar, protein, and other nutrients and convert them into nutrients for both the bacteria and nutrients for the cow. There's a second group you can see, very small, that produce the methane gas. There's also some protozoa that they eat bacteria and ferment starch. And there's some fungi in there that help break down fiber. So we're working with a large group. If we look at how many are in there, this is a chart that based on beef cattle, 40 gallons. Some of our cows may be 50, but each ml of rumen fluid has about 10 billion bacteria, 10 million protozoa, and 1,000 fungi. What's a milliliter? A teaspoon is 5 milliliters. So this is 1/5 of a teaspoon. So that's a lot of microorganisms that we're working with in this animal. Next slide. And where are they located? Well, the rumen basically has three sections. The rumen fluid part with the bugs in there. There's a rumen fiber mat, and then there's a gaseous phase. So the bugs are down in the rumen fluid portion of the system. Next slide. There's a symbiotic relationship between the cows and the rumen. In stage one, the cow provides housing and nutrients for microbial growth. So the cow is sort of the landlord, provides an apartment for the microorganisms to live in. Stage two, then the host animal utilizes some of the rumen microorganisms that go to the intestine as a source of nutrients. So the cow provides a house, but then the cow also wants to rent back to pay for that house. Next slide. So what does the cow provide? We said earlier, low oxygen environment, constant temperature, food for the bugs, a neutral environment, and the cow removes the garbage. Next slide. What do the bugs provide? They break down fiber. They produce a high quality protein. They produce volatile fatty acids, which are energy for the cow. And VFAs are the main energy source for dairy cows. And they're also building blocks for synthesizing milk. Rumen bugs synthesize B vitamins, and they help in amino acid balancing. Next slide. Yeah, there we go. So this is a quick overview of what happens. The feed comes in, it has different fractions, non-protein nitrogen, carbohydrates, and other forms of nitrogen. Those are converted by the microorganisms into microbial protein. Microbial protein then goes to the intestine as a source of metabolizable protein. And that is really a source of amino acids. And the amino acids then are used either to grow muscle and tissue, or the amino acids go down to support milk and milk protein. So that's a simple schematic of the rumen system. Next slide. Dr. Mary Beth Hall, University of Florida, put this together and shows a similar thing. When protein enters the rumen, it either goes to ammonia, which is then converted with carbohydrates to microbial protein. The microbial protein then becomes absorbed protein as a source of amino acids. Next slide. Dr. Varga at Penn State put this together on the carbohydrate side. We have two sides of the equation. We have the sugars and starches, which are highly rumenly available, and they stimulate microbial growth and digestion. And on the right side, we have the fiber, which is more slowly available and stimulates chewing, rumination. Some of that is digestible, and also the chewing stimulates saliva production. And some of these cows may produce as much as 70, 80 gallons per day of saliva. We have to balance these two to keep the rumen bugs happy. They need both the rapidly available and the more slowly available in the right proportions to maximize their growth and development. Next slide. So the generalized equation real quick, carbohydrates plus bugs plus nitrogen plus the anaerobic environment equals volatile fatty acids, which are energy for the cow and building blocks for milk. More bugs, we get microbial protein, and that's the primary source of amino acids in the intestine for the cow. There is some methane, some carbon dioxide, and some other gases produced in that rumen during this fermentation process. Next slide. And what about methane? Methane is a natural product of carbohydrate fermentation and degradation. So the plant material enters the animal, bacteria ferment it. During that process, there's some hydrogen and CO2 that are released. The methanogens, which are a specific type of bacteria, then take hydrogen and CO2, combine that to make methane. So if the animals function at all, there will always be some methane produced. We cannot eliminate methane. Our goal is to try to lower the amount of methane produced. Next slide. This is another chart that looks at methane production. The VFAs, we said, are a source of energy. We get the carbon dioxide, the hydrogen, the methane. And the other effect to remember is if we produce methane, that's loss of energy the animal does not have to make milk. So again, methane is always going to be there, but we want to minimize the amount so we maximize conversion of feed into milk. Next slide. One of the challenges we face is this chart. As cows eat more feed and the rumen is more active, there's more methane produced in terms of grams or liters per day. So today's dairy cows produce a lot more methane per cow than the cows did 20 years ago because they ate less feed. Next slide. However, when we look at the methane production per unit of milk produced, the higher producing cows, since they're more efficient in converting feed to milk, produce less methane per unit of milk produced. Next slide. So what's the unique role of the ruminant in this whole process? Well, cellulose is the most abundant carbohydrate in nature and has a specific linkage that humans and monogastric don't have the enzymes to break down. So you and I cannot directly use cellulose. However, the ruminants have the microorganisms, and the microorganisms are able to produce a cellulase enzyme to break that bond so that the cellulose can become available as a source of energy and nutrients for the ruminant animal. And that way we can convert feeds that you and I can't eat directly into high quality products like meat and milk to use in our diets. And the point is, if these feeds were not used by the cat, by ruminants, most of them would end up in landfills, be incinerated, composted, or disposed of in some other method. So the cow is really the original recycler of many of these compounds. Next slide. So I talk about co-products. For example, if you take wheat and you make flour, you get co-products like wheat mids, wheat bran, and a couple other products, high fiber materials. The one estimate is that if we take 100 pounds of food to process into, say, flour or something, about 37 pounds of that 100 are co-products, which can't be directly used by you and I in our diets. And how much is out there? Well, soybean meal in the United States is about 51 million tons a year. So we either feed that or we really don't have a good use for it otherwise. Distillers grains from ethanol production, around 38 million tons. And if not fed to animals, as we said, they'd end up in landfills or other ways because they have limited value in human diets. Next slide. Next. Next. This is an example of some of the co-products that end up. On the top left, you see bakery and bagels and stuff. Those could be day old or can't be used. There's chocolate that doesn't meet specifications, and there's a lot of other feeds. So the animals can use all of these and convert them into meat and milk. Next slide. This is a list that Tom Overton put together many years ago, showing that from all the different processes we use to make food for people, whether it's oil extraction, brewing, grain milling, or other processes, every one of these has some type of a co-product that potentially is a valuable feed for animals. And many of these directly are not, you could not be directly used by the humans. Next slide. So the US EPA has put together a food recovery hierarchy that says, what do we do when we have these types of materials and or food wastes? Well, the first one is obviously find ways to reduce the amount of waste to start with. Secondly, how much of this can we feed to hungry people? Some of that's very good for people. And then if it's not good for people, the next best option is feeding animals. And you can see now at the bottom, landfill is the last option. So anything we can do to move these co-products and food waste through animals really improves the situation for everybody. Next slide. How much do we feed of co-products? A recent survey showed that the average in the US was about 17.6 pounds per day from co-products for dairy cows. If we fed that amount to all dairy cows in New York, that'd be 5,400 tons per day of co-products that our New York dairy cows are consuming. I surveyed a bunch of herds and found 25% of the ration, the California people, 41%. So basically 25, 40% of our total ration are these co-products that cows consume that are inedible by people. Next slide. And here's just an example ration. This is actually from a real farm. 55% of that ration is forage. That's not going to be used by you and I. 30% was co-products. So the only part of this total dairy ration that could be used by humans is that 12%, which is corn grain. Humans can get some use out of corn grain. So 85%+ of what this cow is consuming are materials that are not edible by you and I. Other surveys show that 75% and higher, and there's herds in New York fed grass-fed milk, their 100% of their ration is not edible by humans. Next slide. So let's talk about human edible protein production. It's just a simple calculation that we can use to help look at the importance of ruminants in producing high quality food. There's two factors in this equation. HEC, human edible protein consumed. How much human edible protein do cows eat? And the second part is how much human edible protein do cows produce? And we want to look at the ratio as their index of efficiency. We want that ratio to be greater than one. We get more human edible protein produced than the cow consumes. That's our goal. Next slide. So let's look at an example from a research study done in Sweden a number of years ago. The controlled diet had cereal grains, wheat, oats, barley, and soybean meal. And then they put together three co-product diets that were fed, and they totally replaced the cereal grains and soybean meal. So they used only co-products like beet pulp, distiller's grains, heat-treated rapeseed meal. So the co-product diets had no cereal grains, no soybean meal. Next slide. So what was the ratio? Well, the controlled diet, the cows were producing less human edible protein than they were consuming. That's not good. But when we went to the co-product diets, you can see that they were making 2.5 times as much human edible protein in the milk than they consumed. So the next slide. So that's good. The next step is then, what's the quality of the protein? Not only how much, but how good. And there's been protein quality scores evaluated saying that the animal protein quality is 1.4, 1.8 times higher in protein quality than plant proteins for human edible for humans. So when we put both quantity and quality together, the value of animal product proteins is about 2.15 times higher than human edible plant protein. So the animal protein is a high quality, high value product for humans. Next slide. So let's move to sustainability. What's a goal? Definitions, everybody has definitions. This is one used by the USDA in 1990. We want to satisfy human food and fiber needs. We want to balance environmental quality and the natural resource base. We want to make most efficient use of our non-renewable resources and on-farm resources, sustain the economic viability of farms, enhance quality of life for farmers and society. That's sort of the goal. Next slide. Why is it important? A recent survey showed that greater than 50% of consumers buying dairy products are interested in the availability of sustainability information. And that number is only going to get bigger as we move ahead. And there's also increasing pressure from processors to adopt and document sustainability practices to be able to maintain access to markets. And again, this will be more important in the future. Next slide. Next. So has the industry made progress? This was a study done years ago that showed that between 1944 and 2007, what changes happened in carbon footprint. On the left panel, you see the carbon footprint per cow doubled during that time. Well, that makes sense. The cows in 2007 were making a lot more milk. They were bigger cows eating more feed. So they were obviously processing a lot more material through the rumen. However, if you look at the panel on the right, the carbon footprint per kilogram of milk produced was decreased by two-thirds. So they really did make a really big change in efficiency when you look at carbon footprint per unit of milk produced, reduced it about two-thirds. Next slide. And then the follow-up study was looked at 2007 to 2017. Milk yields per cow went up about 4,500 pounds per cow. And if you look at every gallon of milk produced in 2017 versus 2007, it used 17% less feed, 21% less land, 30% less water, 20% less fuel, and the carbon footprint went down 19%. So we decreased carbon footprint twice, once between 44, 2007, and then 2007 to 2017. So the industry has made significant progress. There's still ways to go. We have made a lot of progress. Next slide. There's a national program that recognizes dairy farms for their sustainability efforts. And this is just the list of the ones in the Northeast that have won this award in the last few years. You'll see these are in Vermont, Pennsylvania, New York. Two of our New York herds are represented. These herds have been represented for outstanding efforts to improve sustainability of their operations. Next slide. Next. What about changes in New York? So Dr. Kristen Reed at Cornell and I, in cooperation with the Northeast Agribusiness Feed Alliance, said, what's changed in New York between 1999 to 2019? So we used typical diets, used our Cornell ration formulation model to see what changes occurred. Next slide. The number of dairy cows went down about 11%. Milk per cow per year went up about 40%. Total New York milk production went up about 26%. So we had some really improvements in productivity. Cows had to eat more feed, that went up. But notice that we reduced ration protein went down about 11%. Ration phosphorus went down almost 19%. So we improved productivity, but we lowered the amount of nitrogen and phosphorus consumed in the ration. Next slide. So what does this really mean? At the end of the day, if we calculate the change, the total amount of manure nitrogen tons per year produced went down about 8%. Total manure phosphorus tons per year went down 20%. Total ammonia emissions went down 17%, and our total New York methane emissions tons per year went down about 3%. So even though we have more productive cows, we have been able to reduce environmental impact in New York, and that's an ongoing process that we can do more of in the future. Next slide. Economics. None of this works unless farms are profitable. So we did a three-year study with 8 herds in the Upper Susquehanna watershed. We lowered the diet protein, decreased manure excretion about 14%. Milk production went up just slightly, but the big number here was income over purchase feed cost went up by $137 per cow per year. So we made the cows more efficient in converting feed to milk, decreased excretion of nutrients to the environment, and improved profitability of the dairy farm. That helps sustainability. Next slide. A similar project was done in the New York City watershed. And again, when you look at the herds, they targeted the lower phosphorus. Manure phosphorus excretion went down 21%, manure nitrogen down 8%. And again, increase in income over purchase feed was up $157. So both of these studies and others we've done show that generally when we make cows more efficient, reduce excretion of the environment, we also improve profitability, which is a key to maintaining sustainability of a dairy farm. Next slide. So then we said, well, let's do a whole herd simulation. And we used a model from Dr. Al Rotz at the Pasture Lab in Penn State. It used a 1,500 cow New York dairy herd. And this model integrates animals, land, crops, manure, and economics. Evaluates all of those, integrates them. As we change things, how do these shift? So we wanted to evaluate the impact of best management practices to reduce the environmental impact of the farm. Next slide. The model said that when we may implement our best management practices, and we'll talk about it with those in a minute, milk production went up, total farm nitrogen loss went down 46%, net return per cow went up 27%. So again, milk was up, returns were up, but we lowered the environmental impact. Next slide. So if we look at what happened to the carbon footprint in kilograms of carbon CO2 equivalents per kilogram of milk, the base situation was one, which is very similar to the previous estimates of the carbon footprint of milk production of US cows. When we implemented feed best management practices, alterations in forage quality, ratio of forage to grain, and the fat feeding levels, we reduced carbon footprint about from 1 to about 0.8. And then when we put in the best management practices for field crops and manure, like adding cover crops, for example, and going to an anaerobic digester instead of an open lagoon, carbon footprint went from 1 down to about 0.6. So in this New York farm simulation, we could have a significant impact on the carbon footprint per unit of milk by just employing some readily available, naturally available best management practices. There's still ways to go maybe below the 0.6. Next slide. Next slide. So the key points. The dairy industry has made significant progress in improving the efficiency of milk production while improving profitability and decreasing emissions to the environment. There's still opportunities, and we're continuing to move this trend in this direction. Dairy cows and other ruminants can convert large quantities of human edible feeds into high quality proteins for use in human diets. And 75 to 85% of the feed consumed by dairy cows is not edible by humans and would end up in landfills or compost or incineration. Next slide. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Larry. That was fantastic overview of what's going on and how great it is to have cows in a cold winter climate like ours, where this stored cellulose can be used in the wintertime. Jen has just posted a quick poll just to give us feedback on this webinar. So if you could fill out that poll, that would be great. We will now entertain questions. Just the first question, we did not apply for ARPIS credits or continuing education credits for those that asked that question. So Larry, Peter Lehner asks, are corn and soy cellulosic? Is it the case that the grain heavy diet cows are generally fed largely corn and soy, unlike grass, do not require a rumen to be digested?
Would you repeat that question? I didn't catch it.
Okay. Well, there's several parts to it.
Okay.
First question is, are corn and soy cellulosic?
They have very small amounts, not much.
Okay. Is it the case that the grain-heavy diet cows are generally fed largely corn and soy, unlike grass, and therefore do not require a rumen to be digested?
That would be true in the beef feedlot situation, because there they feed about 80 to 90% of the ration is corn, grain, and soybean meal. In the dairy cow, if we look at the amount of corn, grain, and soybean meal, you saw in that one chart I had, in that particular ration, about 12% of the ration was corn. So, you know, corn and soybean are a small part of a total ration.
Okay.
And we've got enough experience with co-product feeds that we can replace the corn and soy totally and still make a lot of milk. We've done trials at the Dairy Forage Center in Madison on that. And we don't need corn and soy. Why do we feed corn and soybean to dairy cows? They're a good source of energy and protein. They're available and they've been relatively cheap. But we don't have to feed those. We can feed co-products and still make the milk. So it's just, I think, availability and economics are the reason we fed corn and soybean. But there's still only a small portion of the total ration.
Okay, thank you. So Tom Hilken asks, do pasture dairy cows produce less methane than those fed a grain or food byproduct diet?
The amount of methane produced when you feed forage only will be a little bit higher than when you feed some carbohydrate like starches along with it. A lot of that will depend on the quality of the forage, but usually the high forage diet is a little higher in methane production because you don't have these starches. And propionate from starch is a sink for methane in the rumen. So that doesn't mean high forage rations are bad at all, but you will make a little bit more methane with the high forage ration without starches.
And we'll hear more about that from Andre in the next. Right. Okay, Ron Gamble. So thank you. So Ron Gamble then asks, we hear about the cows have four stomachs. Where does the rumen come into this? Just what is chewing the cud? Is it just going back to the same place?
Yeah, when the feed enters the rumen, the cow has to chew it to some extent to get it to swallow it. Then it goes in the rumen, forms a bolus, you might say. That bolus is then regurgitated back up to the mouth. They chew again. They're trying to reduce particle size to get small enough that it can eventually exit the rumen. And the cow's going to chew 40 or 50,000 times per day to get these boluses broken down small enough so the particle can pass out of the rumen. So that's where the chewing, rumination, rumen mat formation comes in.
That's a lot to ruminate.
Oh. Yep. Cows spend 9 to 11 hours a day chewing and ruminating. They work hard.
That's amazing. Okay, so Brett Chedzoy asks, why the dramatic difference between a beef feedlot ration and a dairy ration in terms of starch, parentheses, grain? What's the performance or output objective difference between a dairy cow and a beef animal?
Well, the feedlot animal, you're trying to get the maximum rate of gain and high feed efficiency, and you're only going to feed them for about, you know, 4, 5, 6 months, and then they're gone. The dairy cow, we want them to be around for a long time, and so we take advantage of the homegrown forages that we grow on our farms and the co-products to make that ration economical. And so the dairy cow really is a forage-based situation. So that's why we feed the dairy cow that way. Most of our cows are using the forages grown in the farm, where in the beef feedlots, they accumulate animals from all over into an area, have to buy all the feed in. And so it's a lot easier to use grains rather than a lot of forages in. Plus they get better gain and efficiency and profitability with a high grain diet.
Okay, if anybody else has questions, please add them into the question and answer. I have a question for you, Larry, and it has to do with your last slide. where you combine all of your best management practices and you anticipate that it's possible that we could get down basically 40% of the emissions from current base emissions. So that's awesome because that helps us meet our 2030 goal in New York State, where we have a mandate to reduce our emissions 40% by 2030. What is the probability or possibility you think that we could get this down to 85% by 2050, or what the dairy industry goals of a net zero dairy? Can you talk about what are your thoughts on how much further we could go beyond what you all did in 2018 in the Beltman paper?
Well, I think that's the question that the whole industry is looking at now. And as you know, the DMI has the net zero initiative by 2050, and they've got a 5-year plan of research, and they're using some pilot farms right now too, to see where we can go. But there's some new technologies coming along, I think, that'll help us maybe get lower than that 0.6 we ended up with. How much lower we can go, I think it's going to take us a few years to find that out as technologies come along. And the other challenge we have to think about is that some of these technologies fit on certain farms, especially the ones with manure systems where you have to put in equipment. They fit really on the larger farms. They are maybe too expensive in the smaller farms. So there may be a difference in the type of farm as to which technologies we can use and adapt. And as we know more about rations for cows, we're going to do better there. There's some feed additives that look very promising, but none of them, they're not yet available that have potential to reduce methane. So I think there's some things on the horizon. We can probably go lower in 0.6. How much lower? I guess we'll know that in 5 or 10 years.
Thank you. Okay, so Brett has another question. I've heard that modern dairy cow is kept for less than 2 lactations due to having too much protein in their diet, presumably due to liver issues. Is that true? And how could your recommendation be used to improve that statistic?
Yeah, I think the average lactation length is somewhere like 2.5 or something like that. And it's not from protein, because really, if we look at the cows in the US, cows in New York, we're feeding a lot less protein today than we did even 10 years ago. So it's not protein. It's just, I think in many herds, as cows get older, they may or may not have some other challenges, or maybe they've got some new younger cows coming in and they prefer to milk a younger cow instead of the older cow. So I don't think we're losing a lot of our cows are not getting lost because of the high protein, because we're not feeding that much anymore. I think it's just a management practice. There's many herds, though, if you go in and look at them, they've got cows out there that are 6, 8, 10 years old. So there are cows out there that are pretty old at times.
Okay, so Peter Lehner has another question. Could you please talk about the accuracy of enteric methane emissions? I've read some recent studies suggesting the current models are not that accurate.
Well, anytime you look at a thing like methane, we have some challenges. Number one, measuring methane in experiments, there's always a standard error, standard deviation, and that can be very high at times, depends on the system. And Andre may address that a little bit. And then secondly, as we develop models to predict methane, we have to build it off the research data. Well, there's variability in the research data, so there's going to be some variability in the model. So the way I tend to look at it is, yes, I can run a model and say that instead of 450 grams per day, we reduce it down to 420. Now, it probably 450 is not exactly correct. The 420 is not exactly correct, But I think the directionality is correct, that we, by making a change, we did reduce it. So all of these numbers always have standard deviations beside them. And there's a lot of models out there. They all are a little bit different, but we just have to sort of take the best information we have right now, use a model, do our prediction, and look at directionality, and never say that it's exactly this many grams and that many grams, but it's changed by about roughly this percentage.
So if anybody has any more questions, please put them in the Q&A. So I'm going to follow up on that. Larry, do you have information? I think Cornell has these stalls that they're supposed to be installing, and Mike Van Amberg might be doing some studies to get more accurate measurements of enteric methane. Is that, do you know much about that? Could you talk about that a little bit?
Well, Joe McFadden and Mike Van Amberg have gotten some funding to build some stalls on campus. Basically, you put a cow inside of a chamber where you can measure total inflow and outflow of air and gases. So they'll be able to get some direct measurements. I think that's probably not gonna, I think they're just getting ready to start building the stall. So it'll probably be a year or two before you see many results. Most of the original methane work in the United States was done in that type of an environment at USDA Beltsville, Maryland, had an excellent system like that. Unfortunately, at some point in time, the government decided it was too expensive and shut that system down. So now we're getting back to building that type system. But, and then there's some indirect methods. Andre will talk about the method he's used, which doesn't need a stall, but it does still give a way to measure methane emissions by cows. So we'll be getting some more data. And again, even in the chamber, there's always variability day to day and cow to cow.
Okay, so I have another question. So this idea, can you talk a little bit about the basics of what a feed amendment is and how that impacts the methane emissions, and then if you might share some of your favorite feed amendments beyond feed efficiency. Like you've been talking about how to improve the milk production efficiency just using the natural biology of the cow. And so could you just talk a little bit more about what you think is what you think are some promising feed amendments that can help change the conditions inside of the cow so that the total methane is reduced?
There are a number of feed additives, you might say, that are being looked at in research. And they seem to be able to reduce methane anywhere from 5 to say 30%. The challenge with most of them is right now the data is very early. A lot of it's lab data. There's only one or two that have actually gone to a cow trial and a long-term cow trial. And in at least one, and they, once they get data, then they may, depending how they decide to market it, they may have to go through FDA to get approval. So it could be a slow process. So right now, the best way to reduce methane is to get a high quality, well-balanced ration, keep the animal healthy, and that's the best we can do. And we can lower methane significantly by doing that. Like you saw on that slide, we went from carbon footprint of 1 to carbon footprint of 0.8, employing what we have available right now. So we probably can, again, go down from 0.8, maybe a little bit lower than that, but I think that's where we are. 5 years from now, maybe there'll be a number of additives out there, but right now there's none really commercially working at this point.
This has been a production of Cornell University on the web at cornell.edu.